nonetheless, this morning we just want to bring a word to you from Luke 1 and 34 real quick. But before we do that, we just want to pray and ask God to bless this word. Would you bow with us, please? God, we're so grateful for your presence in this place. Your presence is our priority. And Father, we just ask that you would just bring your word to life for us this morning in this short time where we're together. And just help us to experience life change in an amazing way. Help us to leave this place encouraged and inspired, Father God, to be who you have called us to be. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Everybody said
amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. If you have your word, we're going to go to Luke chapter 1. We're going to start at verse 34. And this is the passage of the Christmas story where the angel has come and he's telling Mary, you're going to have a baby. We're going to pick up in verse 34. It says this. Mary asked the angel, but how can this happen? How many of you guys have ever just had that kind of conversation with God? When he begins to like speak to your heart, maybe he's telling you to do something and you're thinking to yourself, but God, how can I do that? God, how can this be? This is where Mary was at that moment. She said, I'm a virgin. The angel replied, listen, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy. And he will be called the Son of God. I want you to just pause for a moment. I want to remind you that this young girl, Mary, was probably, we don't know for sure, but she was probably 13 or 14 years old. If you're a 13-year-old, raise your hand. There we go. We got a couple. Look at these boys. 13-year-old boys. Now imagine, we don't have any 13-year-old girl, I guess, in this room. Imagine that God looks down and he says, I want to do something amazing in this world. I'm going to make an opportunity for people to come back into a real relationship with me like I wanted from the beginning in the garden. And I'm going to choose to do it through that little 13 or 14-year-old little girl. Can you imagine? I mean, like, we don't give our kids that kind of responsibility today, do we? I mean, we tell them to clean their room or take out the trash, and 2 days later, you're like, what is that fucking smell going on? Coming down the hallway, and you're like, oh, they don't listen. But man, God had so much faith in a 13 or 14 year old little girl that he said, I'm going to choose you. Maybe, just maybe, it was because an adult would have really questioned and said, this isn't possible. There's no way this could ever happen. I'm not even going to try. But Mary, that's not what Mary did. Mary looked at that angel and she said, okay, I'm willing. I don't understand. I can't comprehend. But she said, I'm willing. And the angel, in verse 37, I love this passage. You should highlight it in your word. It says this, for with God, nothing will be impossible. For with God, nothing will be impossible. Mary, no doubt, could not understand. She heard the fact that she was going to carry the Son of God. She understood that his name was going to be Jesus. But did you notice any other blueprints laid out? None. That's it. This is how much I'm telling you. Now what you got to do is take one step at a time in obedience. And Mary was willing to do it. She was willing to just step out. Even though she didn't understand, God was saying, I know you don't understand. All I'm asking you to do is one thing. Trust me. All I'm asking you to do is trust me. And today, that same message is being spoken to each and every one of us. And God is looking down and he says, look, wherever you are in your life, whatever is going on in your circumstances, it doesn't make any difference what the doctors are saying. It doesn't make any difference what's going on in the relationships in your home. It doesn't matter because with me, all things are possible. I'm asking you to do one thing. I'm asking you to trust me. Take it one step at a time. That's what Mary did. I want you guys to think about this. We know the story. We see it away in a manger. Jesus was born and he was laid in a manger. But I want to show you what an actual manger in that day and time would have looked like. If you look at the screen, a manger would have looked very similar to this. It would have been like a stone or what we would think of concrete, but it would have been stone. Kind of box that was just hollowed out. And this, honestly, was just a feeding trough. It was just a place where hay was laid, and then the animals would consume it. I want you to know that during the first century when this was taking place, the people would have animals that actually lived in their homes. Now today, lots and lots of people have dogs and cats and rats and, I mean, some things you welcome, some things you don't, that live
family.
In your home.
Not this family.
What, the rats?
No. No animals.
No animals.
In our home.
We have a no animal rule.
We need to discuss.
Well, when Brad and I got married, Mary if he wanted to have animals in the house, and I said, you and my kids will be enough of a mess in our home.
Not just animals, only one animal.
What animal?
German Shepherd.
Yeah.
In my house.
And what did I say?
No.
They can live outside. But I want you to understand that in this day and time, what would happen is there would be at least two stories. And on the bottom level, and you can go to that next slide, on the bottom level, the animals would live. So you can kind of see, this was an Israelite home, and the animals would be down on the bottom level, and there would have been a manger in that zone. The family would have lived up on top, okay? And so when Mary had baby Jesus, she would have gone into that zone right there, and she would have given birth and laid baby Jesus into that empty, hollow, rough, dirty manger. But what I want you to really notice about this is this was very, very common. This was not unusual. This was common. Everybody had it. It's like everybody has a dog in America, right? I mean, it was very common. Everybody had mangers. Most of them had two or three. It was no big deal. This was something that they used all the time. And you say, well, why in the world are you bringing all this up? I bring it up because of this. The Israelites, their entire life, heard the story of the Messiah coming. They knew that one day the Messiah was going to come, and they imagined what that would look like. And they pictured in their head how he would appear and how he would live and what it would look like and what he would do when he got there. Just like maybe before you got married, you had a picture in your mind of what your wedding would look like and what your marriage would look like. And some of you guys are like, yeah, and it didn't all look the way that I pictured it in my head, right? That is exactly what the Israelites had done. They had got this picture in their head of how the Messiah would come. And they thought, man, he's going to be this warrior, and he's going to come and he's going to deliver us from the Roman rule, and he's going to be amazing. He's going to probably live in a palace. They never dreamed in a million years that something so common as a feeding trough, a manger that everybody had, that Jesus would be born and laid in that manger. They never dreamed in a million years that God would choose to do something so incredible with something so ordinary. You hear what I'm saying? They never dreamed that God would do something so extraordinary with something so ordinary. You know, each one of us today, we stand before God and we think to ourselves, who am I that I could do anything? Who am I that God would choose me? Why would God even love me? I'm not worthy. Man, if you knew my past, there's no way that God wants to have a relationship with me. If you knew what I've done, if you knew where I came from. But yet I'm telling you that today, God is speaking the same thing to us. Even though we don't understand the future, even though today you may say, I didn't have a relationship with God because I've never felt like I could, because my past haunts me. I'm telling you, with God, all things are possible. God can cover you today. God can do something extraordinary with somebody very, very ordinary.
Good. Look with us for a moment at Luke 2. We're going to look at verses 9 through 13. It says that suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified, but the angel reassured them. Don't be afraid, he said. I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. And you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in the strips of cloth, lying in a manger. So Misty just gave you the historical background of the first century Jews and really how the manger fit into their realm of life each and every day. The question I want to ask you, and this is so powerful if you can get a hold of this, why did God choose to use that very common thing to do something so unbelievably uncommon? You see, it was not typical to put a baby in a manger because the manger... If you can go back to that picture, if you will, of what the manger looked like, and hold that right there.
It doesn't look like a baby.
It doesn't look like a crib to me. In fact, I want to really paint a picture for you. In that day and time, how many of you guys have ever had cattle or horses or livestock of any sort, just raise your hand. All right, awesome. So you know that it would probably not be the best thing to do to go lay your baby in that feed trough, correct? Not the first place I would think of to lay my baby, right? But it's all they had. Why did God use that?
You look at this feed trough, if you will, and you notice that it's very, very rough. It's very hard, and it's very hollow. The reason God used the manger is because this is a perfect symbol of our heart without Jesus. Our heart without God is hard, and it's rugged, it's rough, and it's hollow. We spend our entire lives searching and seeking for things to fill that hollow heart. Think about the cycles that we put ourselves through, right? We say, if I can just make more money, my heart will be full. If I can just have a child, my heart will be full. If I can just marry the right person, right? My heart will be full. If I can get a new house, if I can just get a new car, if I can get that job, right? If I can attain this sort of level, right, of status in society, I will be full, right? As pastors, we constantly see it all the time. We're counseling person after person after person. And really, all stories are different, but it leads to the same place. There's an emptiness, and there's a hollow portion of their heart. And that's the part of their heart that does not have Christ. Because when you have Jesus, you realize that you don't need anything else. Those things are okay. There's nothing wrong with having a nice car. There's nothing wrong with having the perfect mate. There's nothing wrong with having a nice house or any of those things. The best job, there's nothing wrong with it. But when you seek those things for fulfillment and happiness and hope, I'm telling you, you're looking in the wrong place. Right? We have some horses at the house, and there's been times, okay, when they ran out of hay. There's been times when at night when we get home, right, they're waiting for the grain to hit the feed trough. And they're standing at the gate and they're looking at us and they're like, when are you going to feed me, dude?
I actually have a donkey and the donkey will scream.
She hollers. Like when you pull in the driveway and you get out, like, aw, aw, and she hollers at you and she's saying, feed me.
She doesn't stop until
you get the grain. Put it in the feed trough because she is hungry and it's time to eat. Why are they screaming? We don't starve our animals, okay? I'm just saying that when we get home, they know.
Just like our children.
When we pull in the driveway, they know it's really close to getting some grain and they want some yummy, yummy grain in their bellies. And they start hollering at us and they stand at the fence and they're like, hey, guess what? My tummy is empty. There's nothing in the feed trough, right? And that's what people do without Christ each and every day. They stand in the fence and say, hey, my heart is empty. I'm searching for something. I need something to come and fill my empty heart. And I'm telling you that there is nothing in this life that is going to fill your heart than Jesus himself. When you come to Christ, you get to experience a real and life-changing relationship with Jesus that is contagious. There's nothing like it. There's nothing like living for Almighty God. Is life perfect? No. That's just it. But we are in the perfect position to be able to handle life because now we've got God, Jesus himself, filling our hearts, making us whole, and making us full. That's exactly what he wants to do. You know, maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor Brad, look, don't preach at me. You came to the wrong place. Should have come. You know, we love having these kids' productions. We love watching our kids perform. We love it, man. They are the stars of the show. They're awesome. Truth be told, we love you enough that we want to do anything we need to do to get you here, even if it's through these awesome, wonderful, beautiful kids, to get you to sit in these seats and listen to this one thing. God loves you so much. He loves you so much, and he has been trying your entire life to get your attention. And don't think for one second that God did not orchestrate this moment for you to be here right now, sitting in this seat that you're sitting in, so that he can talk directly to you. Did you ever think about the fact that God, the creator of the universe, the one who hung all the planets where they hang, and he gave all the stars names, and he has every one of these beautiful hairs numbered. So if I was to pull one of these hairs out, which I won't, he has a number for that hair. That same God that thinks about you at night while you're sleeping. And the Bible says his thoughts for you are as many as the grains of sand. He loves you so much. Did you know that you can talk to him? And did you know this morning he is trying to talk to you? And here's exactly what he's saying. I love you. I love you so much. I sent my one and only son so that you could have life and have it more abundantly. You may not be rich. You may not have the best job. You may not have the nicest house or the nicest car. You may not win the lottery. And you might try, you know, head to the casino and try to hit it big. You know what? That's not going to make you happy. It's not. He's saying, I want to make you happy. I want to fill your feed trough heart. And there's nothing greater than my son Jesus. That's why he came. That's why he did what he did. And he's telling you this morning that he loves you so very, very much. And he wants to be in your heart and he wants to be in your life. Amen. He loves you. If you would stand up with us today, I want to pray with you. And I want to give you an opportunity. This is something that we do every single Sunday at Mountain Movers Church. And this really hinges on why we do what we do as a church. Every single week, I'm going to give you an opportunity for your life to never ever be the same again. I'm going to give you an invitation to come and know Jesus. So you say, Pastor Brad, I don't want to change my life. I would have to do so much. I'd have to change my friends, and I have to think differently and act differently. And talk. Listen, that's the enemy of your mind. Don't listen to that junk. Do we have to change when we come? Yeah, we do, but it's not in your strength, it's in his. And it's not about a list of rules. It's not about the do's and the don'ts. It's about really just having a real relationship with him and wanting to live for him. Because he gave himself for you. He loves you so much. And this might be a moment where God is just saying, hey, I've called you to this place. This is the opportunity. I want you to invite me into your heart this morning. Is God saying that to you? Is he saying that to you? If he is, I want to pray with you right where you're at. And here's how we do it. We pray as a family all together. We just all pray together right where you're at. And you can know Christ today, which means you can have heaven as your home forever and ever and ever and ever. Amen? Think about eternity. Each and every one of us in this room will live forever. The question is, where have you made your home? Where will you live? I hope your choice is heaven. Amen. So this is what it's about. When we give our lives to Christ, it's about admitting that we have fallen short. And it's called sin. In our culture, it's a very offensive word. You know what? Our sin offends God greatly. And we're all sinners, the Bible says. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. So we have to admit that we're sinners. And we have to ask God to forgive us. We have to believe that Jesus is who he says that he is. And confess with our mouths that he is Lord. And then dedicate our lives from this moment forward that we're going to do everything within our power to live according to his word. Because it's not about us. It's all about him. So if you would, please bow your heads and close your eyes. And I want to give you the opportunity of a lifetime, an offer that you cannot or should not refuse. With all heads bowed and eyes closed, I'm going to count to three. And on the count of three, if you're in this place and you say, Pastor Brad, I am the representation of that hollow heart that you were talking about just a moment ago. My heart is a stony manger. It's rough, and it's rugged, and it's totally and completely empty. Pastor Brad, I've been searching for so many different things to make me happy. Maybe you say, Pastor, I leaned on alcohol. Maybe you'd say, Pastor, I leaned on sex and different addictions, and I leaned on money and greed, and I've dealt with anger and resentment, and I've been hurt. And I have all these things that are weighing down on my heart, and I've tried so many things to try to medicate the pain in my life. So, Pastor Brad, I believe you this morning. I believe that what you're saying is true, that if I invite Jesus into my heart, he is going to fill that void in my heart, and he will become everything I will ever need. I believe you, Pastor Brad. If that's you today, on the count of three, I want you to raise your hand, and then you can put it back down. Are you ready? Life change. Here it comes. This is your moment. This is what you were born for. Right here. Is to know Him and to make Him known. Are you ready? Here we go. We've been praying for you. One, two, three. Who are you? Raise your hand this morning. I see your hand. Anybody else this morning? In the name of Jesus. I see your hand. Amen. I see your hand. Anybody else today? God is calling out to you. He loves you so much. Who else in this place would say, I want Jesus as my Savior. I want Him to live in my heart and rule my life. Anybody else this morning? Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. So, having said that, let's pray as a family together. Would you please repeat this prayer after me? Father, I love you. I thank you for your Son, Jesus. My heart has been hollow, like a stony manger, rough and rugged and empty. I've been searching for all the wrong things, but now I've found you. I admit that I'm a sinner. Forgive me of my sins. I believe that Jesus is who He says He is. I confess with my mouth that He is Lord. I dedicate from this moment forward that I will live for you, God, according to your word. Surround me with godly people that will love me. Make your word my favorite read every day. Make your house, the house of God, my home. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen, 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 amen. Give God a big hand clap of praise if you love Him.
Hey, thanks so much for joining us today. If you want to be a part of something bigger than yourself, give to our ministry. We've made giving easy here at Mountain Movers Church. If you have your smartphone, just text the number 918-223-8090. Just push in the amount you want to give and push send. It's that easy. If you don't have your smartphone, not a problem. You can mail your giving just as easy to 24,000 South 660 Road, Grove, Oklahoma, 74344. Thanks for watching today. Hey, remember, we're dreaming big for you. We'll see you next week.